started since it is a little bit late. This is 10 by 10, and I'll explain what that means in a bit. I'm Elizabeth Dettlinger. I was currently a Spanish teacher here at Nevada, and it is true that I will be leaving. I'm going for a full-time position in Norwalk, so if you're on the south side of Des Moines and want to stop by, that'd be great. Looking for new friends. But I'll be at Norwalk next year. If you haven't already heard, the IWLA will have their fall conference this year, October 12th and 13th, right? Crazy. And it'll be in Inkley this year. So if you're looking for more ideas to see some different people present, for example, Craig Klein couldn't be here with Spanish Cuentos. It's a great time to come because a lot of presenters that are here today go there, and there will be some other sessions. A little bit about my session today. It was inspired during a reading project, so to speak, where my kids were needing more activities in addition to what I was already doing with them. And I needed things I could do that didn't require me to prep so much. I had taken a reading club I had adapted from Allison, and so I had kids that were reading with me, kids that were reading with each other, and then kids that read on their own. And when I surveyed them and got their feedback, their advice, they said they still wanted extra practice in addition to what we did when we read. And so that's where these really came from, because as a new mom, I could not justify going home and spending an hour looking for a new activity to do the next day and prepping it. So that's where this really comes from. Every activity up here takes me 10 minutes or less, so I'll kind of give you my tips. Some of them you have maybe seen in other ones, other sessions today, but hopefully I can help you take less time to prepare. So the first activity, the prep work, for every story, this can be chapter by chapter. If you do more of a TPRS style where you have maybe a different story every day or every week, you take the 10 most important sentences is a pretty good basic number. And then what I recommend is you type them onto a separate document. So for me, I'm going to copy those 10 sentences onto a Google Doc. If you are old school, you can just write them on a normal piece of paper, copy them on the copier. That works perfect too. Having the electronic version is nicer because some of my activities are techie, and so I can just copy those, paste them into what I need. So the primary part is to identify your top 10 sentences and have them on some separate piece of paper, not within your story. So the first activity is charades. And so the way that I do this is a little bit differently. I found that my kids here needed more practice rereading what they had for the more correct reading practice, more correct input with reading, because they were very good about coming up with what they wanted to say, but with some errors, and so I was trying to get more input. So what I will do, the student comes up, and this is Avery. I gave Miss Avery one of the sentences on my paper. So I would circle or highlight, and I point to it. And then what her group's doing is they are looking for the exact sentence. And there's a timer up. I give them 1 minute. So she's up here. She's acting it out. And they're looking for the exact sentence out of the book. If her group gets it right, they get the point. If they don't get it right, the other group can then steal. So that's how I get the buy-in. I usually have two groups. My class size is allowed for that. However, if you have bigger classes, you could have multiple groups. This is one that they liked a lot, especially if they have lots of energy. The writing down your 10 sentences is very important for something like this, if they're looking back in the novel or in the story in front of them, because when they come up to you, they'll see your highlighted sentences, and they'll say, oh, guys, she highlighted that one before I threw that next one up. Or they'll like, see where you're looking at, so if you're pointing to a certain part, they'll kind of do that. So if you have them printed out and separate, it makes them work a little harder, so that's why I do that. The next activity I do is Pictionary. So you can see Kyle here has a hilarious drawing out of Fiesta Fatal that he's trying to get them to do. And essentially, this is the same activity, just instead of charades, They are drying out what they are doing. So he got his sentence, he drew it out, and then his group is trying to find that exact sentence in the book. What is really nice about this, since they're pretty similar activities and you have those sentences out, you can allow them choice. Do you prefer to act? Do you prefer to draw? Because you're just going to have some groups that prefer one or the other, and you don't have to go and prepare a whole other activity to do. You just give them the option. Whatever they like, they'll choose and they'll go with it. So Pictionary and charades work really, really well. The third activity, it is a slight variation on the previous two, and I originally saw something by Christy Placido at IFLT that was something similar. How many of you have whiteboards? I'm just curious. Okay. So this is a whiteboard activity. However, if you don't have whiteboards, you could just have a piece of paper that the kids will hold up. So what you'll do is you'll still have your charades or your Pictionary. Okay. And so Annie comes up here, she's acting it out. What's different about this is that her group is each looking on their own, in their own book, and on their whiteboard, and they each write down their old sentence. So her group down there will each have a sentence. For each person that's right in her group, they get 1 point. So if this is her group here, all three ladies have the right answer. Her group gets 3 points. If one person has the right sentence, they get 1 point. So this one is nice when you find that kids are getting maybe a little lazy, they're not wanting to go in and reread as much, or they're relying solely on like maybe the all-star or somebody who really knew the chapter well. So you can do this with charades or really Pictionary, because the kid up here is really the one doing the activity. But then all of the kids are looking in this one. Yeah.
Do you take away points if they try to give the other students on their team the answer? Or you let them check together?
It kind of depends. I usually try to say no, because if I'm doing this one, it's because I think they're relying on too much on one person, and I'm wanting them to do their own. I'll be honest, I maybe helped some girls cheat one time just because they were down like negative 50 points or something, and so then the boys were all upset. So I mean, I am kind of known for trying to help a group out if they're failing or if they're not doing well. But it's pretty easy going. I don't really like to do a ton of point keeping. I'm just trying to get them to look in the book. So I don't care who wins at the end, and that bothers them. But yeah, whiteboards make it nice because you can erase and then go again. Yeah.
So two questions. What was the 3 point? You said the group receives 1 point per correctly copied down sentence.
Yes.
And so what's 3 points, and how do you know the sentence is copied down? You've done this all, prepared it all ahead of time, what they're going to do?
So I'll have the 10 sentences on my paper. I show Annie number 3. She gets up here and she's acting it out and she's all like this. If this is her group, these 4 people,
okay.
It depends on how many people in her group are correct. So they're going to hold up their sentence that they found that they think Annie's acting out. And the number of correct sentences is how many points they get. So if no one in the group gets it right, that's 0 points.
Is this in the whole book or is this a chapter?
I do it by chapter if it's a book. Yeah. It'd be a lot. Yeah. Like a lot of times. Yeah.
Do you establish the rules? Like they have to have capital letters, periods at the end, accent, or not?
I don't, because I'm so easy going. I just want to know that they can find and read the correct sentence. And so maybe my kids would be better writers if I did that, but when you're scrabbling down something with the, like, really beat up markers, I don't know how well it'll come out anyway, so, yeah.
It depends on what you're focusing on, too, like, upper level,
certain
lower
groups.
Level.
Yeah. Yes, definitely. Are there any more questions about this one? I don't have a really good picture video of it, but, okay, great. So, charades with a twist, Pictionary with a twist. These next one are all true and false activities that I've come across over the time. Two of these actually came off the IFLT NTPRS CI Facebook group, so if you're not in that, this Jenny Robbins is my new favorite person because she saved my sanity at the end of the school year, and kids love these two activities. So the first one up here is a true and false relay race. And she has a video up here, so I'm going to just pull it up. And then I can kind of explain how it works. Oh, wow, that's huge. Okay. So this is a video of her kids playing. So what she does, she's standing down at the end. She's got her sentences, and you've got your teams. They run down. Now she has her kids put them on. One of these says true, and one says false. And so the first one, I guess to get it on their head, is true. But I had some very energetic kids in one class that was all boys. And so what I did is my kids had to run down and then run back with the correct cup. Let me tell you, like, after that long winter we had, kids really, really liked that, like, getting outside. I just use cups. You can really use a lot of different things. I think she's got some kind of pails here. But, like, even if you have, like, stuffed animals, they can run with anything to kind of make it novel. It makes this really great. And it's really low prep, really low stress for you. And kids loved it.
She's reading a statement that's true or false.
Say true and false on those.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay.
So, like, for example, if this were to be false and this were to be true, like color coded, and they're down here, she's going to read them. And then I run, if that sentence is false, you're grabbing whichever one it is.
Thank you, Mother.
And yeah, and going back. So, my kids really like that one a lot. And Allison, I think you did this one too, didn't you?
I haven't done this one yet. I like
no?
this one.
Okay. I thought you had.
Yeah.
This is more good.
Her other one is really good too. So it's a similar concept. I just called it the locker touch. I don't remember what name she gave it. It's going to be the same principle. So you'll look at your 10 sentences, and then you'll read them or tweak them however you see fit. And then kids will touch a side of the hallway depending on what their answer is. So here are her kids. He must be. So it's kind of like musical chairs, but like a different spin. They're just running.
Following the
Yeah. Now the only thing I did run into, this was hard for my big group because I had one group of like 26 or 27. When you have all those kids that are out, it got a little hard. She says her kids get really into looking for who is the last to touch. So I think it's got to be about how you spin whatever you're doing with those kids that are out, but that could be one issue. If your classes are really big, I could see happening. But yeah, my kids really like this one too, and pretty easy to set up and to get going. The third true or false one, I do know Allison does because I found it through her, and it's just the marker grab. And I believe Cynthia Hitz is really the one who kind of, I don't know, developed or found this. So you have your 10 sentences, you'd read them out. And typically how it's set up is you have your partners and they'll have like a marker in between them. You may come away with colors if you're someone who doesn't like kids to have messy hands. Choose something else, but not scissors, because that's an even worse art supply. Stuffed animals. I did have a collection of stuffed animals, and that went really well. So each person's going to sit down, and they're like this, and if they think the sentence is true, they want to grab the marker first. So then when you're done, you count out who has the most points on the sides. And then if they're false, and I still grab it, so I didn't want to do that, it's negative points. But you can kind of determine however you want. If it's just the team with the most true, if you want to penalize those who grab false and shouldn't have, that's kind of up to you.
I've seen it done another way where the team that has the most markers held up, you then ask someone on that team to correct it. And if they get it right, they get a point. And if they get it wrong, the other team gets it.
That is good. I like that. I love stealing because they get so mad. Yeah. So that's a good one.
How many kids do you have? Are they all seated on the floor or just by?
Yeah, it doesn't have to be on the floor. I had these black chairs, so we could just move them out of the way. It was a lot harder in like my last classroom, so I had a lot of desks. But you can do it in the hallway. My kids love anything that involves not being in the classroom. And my principal really liked when he saw me outside with kids. So if I was in the cafeteria or in the parking lot doing this thing, it just shows kids out moving.
And he really seemed to like that, that kids were out moving and moving. So, you know, it's kind of look at your spaces and see what's available to you. Just moving to a new place kind of makes it a little novel.
Yeah, did you have any issues, you know, for example, if you did the relay, only two kids are going at a time, you know, what is everybody else doing? Are they just turning around and talking to their neighbor about what they're doing this weekend? Or, you know, how do you keep the kids engaged who aren't the two that are running down for the
So my bigger class, I did have a little bit of an issue, and so what I started to do was ask them why, and it had to be like someone in their group that was waiting. You can do extra things like when the person that runs back, you pick a random person to justify why. Plus, I don't know, at some level, I don't know if I always think they have to be on, because the this activity, the relay race for the running outside, I kind of felt like kids deserved a little brain break. And so if they were the one always running, I was kind of okay with that. I don't know.
I line them up like if you have 20, like 10 on this team, 10 on this team, with like the relay space in the middle.
Uh-huh.
And I teach them how to cheer in Spanish.
Yeah,
so they have to corre más rápido, vamos, and it's only positive, not negative. So when it's not their turn, vamos, vamos, más rápido, apúrate, things like that. And it's a fast-paced game anyway, so the front person goes to the back, next one, you're always, and it just keeps everybody positive, cheering, vamos, más rápido, I know. Without shouting out answers, you can't tell them which one to do. But that kind of helps with any like board race game, fly swatters, and
competitions.
Yeah.
You can probably also either have more teams so that there's fewer people in line, or like assign numbers to them and be like, okay, single, and then that person.
Ooh, I like that.
So they have to pay attention and then wait for their number and they don't know if it's.
Yeah, the one thing I did with the relay races outside is I would let someone in the back of the row pick how they did it. Because I had one particular class that was not very athletic and had issues running, and so I would let someone else say, oh, are we going to skip? Are we going to walk fast? Are we power walking? And so that kind of seemed to help if they were allowed to help decide how the race was going to go.
They could make up names for those. Spanish, you know, caminar como oso, bear walk,
cangrejo,
jump.
So speaking to the numbers one, I always think of the game as 14, because we had an uneven number of students in that class, and so there were, you know, I counted like from the most of them, you know, like all the way up to 13 on both sides, and then there was a 14 that was like the tiebreaker, and so you would call, like, give them a clue. Everybody gets the clue. Nobody knows whose turn it's going to be. And then you call the number, like, 5. And then those two kids get one of them to be like, Catorce! Like, then that kid takes their spot, and they get to run up.
Yeah.
But, like, they either do it with whiteboards, like, or they write it on there. But that was one of my honors for kids, favorite things too. Because you can get pretty complex with it when they can write a sentence or when they can, you know. And that, it's like the same concept, but...
Or Catorce, they could be pick one person from each team, you know, your best person or whatever.
Out of all three of these up here, the relay races is the only one that my kids didn't even know what the score was at the end. I don't know if it was we were in the parking lot or I didn't like write them down, but like they were just so focused on the running and like grabbing the cones, and that was the one that they seemed to really get into a lot. So if you're not on it, I'm hoping most of you are, but she posts some really good stuff that are really active and get your kids up. So I looked for Jenny Robbins in that group. She's got great stuff. The next one that I've done is Quizlet Live Relays, which is really nice to have that digital version because that's where you can just copy and paste. So the way this works, I'm curious who's already played Quizlet Live?
The relay model.
Okay. Yeah, so all you do with the relay, if you haven't heard of it, what you'll do is you set up your Quizlet Live. And then the groups that are a team set their computers all together. So these three computers here were for one team. So they set them all over here. And so then the group members are all on the other side of the room. And they go one at a time. And what was tricky is they didn't understand that they were looking at all three computers because we played live a lot.
Yeah.
And so it's kind of funny. You get in some extra repetition as they're going, and then they're like, I was supposed to do that. So it gets you a little extra practice if you're not a good describer when you're telling them. But some kids don't like that, so just, you know your audience. There is a lady in this picture. This is one of the only times I saw her smile this year, and she really liked that. So they run down. There's a sentence up at the top, and they're just picking the right one. So this is a translation activity. So that's up to you if you like it.
First and last part of the sentence.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. First and last. If you have the pro account, I think you can match with pictures. So if you've had kids draw certain parts of your chapter out. I'm not that organized, but you could do that too if you have the, Quizlet Pro or whatever they call it. So this is another great one, pretty easy, pretty fast. They asked to do this one 4 or 5 times.
Yeah, Emily?
Another one that kind of builds off of the Quizlet Live Relays with the photos is if you have your kids do like a flashcard factory first where you have them write and draw their own sentences, mm-hmm. and then you can import it and do Quizlet Live Relays with it. Where they have to look for the sentence to match it to the photo.
Yeah,
just as much fun doing the drawings for their sentences and looking at those as they do running around, too. And they'll spend 20, 30 minutes.
You do need the pro account to do that, right?
To do drawings, yeah.
To add the drawings. It's
but
like, what, 35 a year?
Something like that. With the flashcard factory, you can export it to Quizlet, and it'll bring the students' drawings in without having a pro account.
Yeah.
Flashcard factory.
It's from Pear Deck.
Yeah,
it's good.
It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, and they really like looking at the end when you approve or disprove the different cards.
They love it.
They
so
love
to.
You
have
what
your
they
kids
drew.
Make them on the flashcard factory,
mm-hmm.
and then they send them to you.
Well, it automatically exports into you as a part of the game.
Yeah. Oh.
And then you approve or disprove their flashcard at the end.
And you can like make that part of the activity too. Or like,
yeah.
It's buen ejemplo or es mal ejemplo.
Any other tips for Quizlet? The next one is a pretty popular one. I do know Martina has blogged about it before, but it's really quick, easy setup. If you've got your 10 sentences in your doc, what you'll do is you take your 10 sentences, you cut them all up, place them around on the lockers. What the kids are going to do is they run out, they look at the sheet of paper, they're trying to memorize it in their head, they come back and they have a partner write down what they've said. There's a lot of variations you can do. You can add, like, getting them in order if you don't label them for kids. I have to because my kids started repeating a lot of sentences. You can have them draw out the sentences. You could then give them questions about the sentences they've read. For me, trying to keep it simple with the 10, what I typically do, I cut them up, they're out there, they come back, and then they put them in order if I didn't help them do that. But it's a pretty popular one that I know has been going around for a little bit. It's similar to Quizlet Live in the fact that there's running kids like that. It's a pretty popular one. Any questions about Quizlet Live?
Just troubleshooting, have to set up some expectations. Like, you can't come to the door and shove it to your left hand.
We did this, I'm a student teacher, and we did this, and what we said is you don't want to yell it out loud anyway, because then they hear everyone else what they're saying. So, like, that was one of our cues, like, you don't want to say it out loud, because then everyone else will hear exactly what you're saying, and if their partner's gone and they're not doing it, then they can write what you're saying then across the room.
Yeah. I haven't run into too many of those here, just because I used the hallway, and it was, like, kind of far for them, but I did run into an issue with kids that wanted to write versus be the ones running, so I just made them switch every time. I don't know. It's kind of up to you if you want to allow kids to have those preferences or not, but that's a common one I've run into here the last few years, so, yeah. It's a pretty good one. Your athletic kids will really, really like this one. this one here, Sparkle. I'm trying to remember the gal's name I got this from. Her name is Stephanie Prine. Out on the east side of the state.
Sparkle is pretty much the same concept in English, I've been told. I've never played Sparkle in English. I've only played it in Spanish. So you have a PowerPoint or some Google presentation, and you're going to have your 10 sentences. So that's why I like it in my Google Docs. I can just copy and paste right in there. And I do have a template. This is one I used with Fiesta Fatal this past semester. So cheese spas, like sparkles, where's the present button? I don't know, I just didn't work.
F5?
F5?
Mm-hmm. I don't have an F5.
Or go to view.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Perfect, thank you.
Alright, so how I set this up, and this is translation, so give and take. If you don't like it, that's fine. My kids will get up and they're in a circle and they've got a piece of paper and pen at their desk. What they're going to do is, one by one, they translate this sentence into English, sentence in Spanish, or you can do vice versa. So you're going to go and Amanda says, she. Bryce goes, he says, was feeling. We get to Nerviosa and Luisa tells me, mad. So what Luisa is going to do is she'll sit down, and now she's going to have to copy down this sentence on her piece of paper, okay? We keep going, we keep going, we keep going. Melanie's the last one. What I ask her to do is she has to tell me this whole sentence correctly. So Melanie's going to tell me she was feeling nervous because the cartel was very violent. Then Melanie says chispas, sparkle. And the person after her is out. And they have to sit down, and then they copy the next sentence. So kids don't want to sit down, so they're paying attention. And then if their buddy doesn't get it, they're like, crap, that wasn't the word I needed to know. At the end of the year, I only did this 3 times. And the last time I played it, I had a girl saying, are we going to play that game again? Because I really want to win this time. I really want to do good. I'm like, sorry, this is the last time. So your kids that are kind of detail-oriented like this one, it's nice because this goes really quickly. You might think those kids are going to be sitting forever, but they're not. So as soon as all your kids are down or you're left with one, they get back up, and then they're going on the next sentence. So if everyone's down and Lisa's the only one left, well, then everyone gets back up, and you start on the next sentence. So you can kind of play around with this one however you want. If you're with upper levels, I typically will do English and they have to do the Spanish. My lower levels, since I'm still trying to do more input where they're reading it correctly, I give them the Spanish. It's up to you to play with those. Yeah?
Could you explain a little bit more? You said if they get it wrong, then they have to copy down the sentence. Like, can you explain more of what copy down the sentence that they would do something like this? Or?
No, I'm literally just making them copy it to keep them accountable. I don't ever look at them. Well, I scan them, but I'm not giving points because not every kid's going to have the same sentence. I have some kids that get to the end of class, they don't write anything down except their name on the paper. So I don't know how you justify that. It's, for me, honest, it's kind of like a gimmick to get them engaged. I really, as long as they're just following along, if I knew every kid would be sitting there and be like, oh, he ran in their head, that'd be fine. But I know they're going to be checking the cell phone or like trying to talk to their girlfriend across the room. And that's really why I do it. When I started, they never wrote anything down. And I noticed kids started not paying attention and doing that. So that's why I added that part.
Do you stay on one sentence until everybody, you have a winner? Or when do you alternate after the sparkle? Or can you find the flow of the game?
Yeah. So Melanie went, she told us this whole sentence correctly. Melanie says cheese bus or sparkle, the person after her is out. Okay, but we still have people standing. I just move on to the next sentence. So the next person who's still up will translate. I do like Julieta, since it's a name, I say names are out, they don't count. So we'll keep going. You're really going until there's one kid left, and then everyone gets to go back up. The sooner the better. So I'd really rather have them reading this and looking over this and really just copying down for me, but it's a preference. Yeah, it's a translation.
When they copy it down, there's a possibility.
It's however you want. If you're
you're looking for them to be paying attention to what the peers are saying, or if you're wanting them to copy it correctly, if you've given it in Spanish, it's pretty variable.
I'm sorry, I'm just but like the whole class is sitting is standing in a circle, or there are
like spelling
bees. Yeah, kind of like a spelling bee.
But they're writing and not like saying.
The only thing
like,
wrong.
Will this row stand up?
Oh,
you only get wrong.
Gotcha. So
yeah,
you don't just go back to the beginning.
Yeah. Will you sit up, please? Yeah. So I think
it's
a little hard.
Yeah. Let's do this now.
The whole.
Oh yeah. Okay.
All right. So names are out. Say. Julieta won't count, all right? Corio, Nikki.
Ran.
Vivian.
Two.
Two. Sue.
Her.
Dormitorio?
Apartment.
She goes down, okay? So my next person has to tell me dormitorio.
Bedroom.
Woo! So now what she's doing is she's going to copy down this sentence. However you set it up, if you want them to copy in Spanish, or if you want them to write what their peer said, it's up to you. Next person, E. She goes down, right? So she's going to start writing.
E.
And. Woo!
Prepared.
Woo! Sue.
His.
And it's however picky you want to be. If it's Julieta, she, you know, so you got to play with that. Sue.
Her.
Woo! Backpack. All right. So now I've got two left. Nikki has to tell me this whole sentence correctly. And then if Nikki's correct, she tells me chispas. Pobre Angela's out. All right. So we'll pretend Nikki gets it right. She says chispas. Angela's down. All right. Now here's the thing. Because this is the whole sentence, I just have everyone stand back up. Right? But if maybe we have three or four people left, then we go to the next sentence until I have one kid.
Is
this like
copier?
Is just accountability thing?
Until there's one person left.
So
yeah,
they
have to copy everyone's sentence.
If they're sitting down, yeah. And you can tweak the rules however you want. If you want it like one sentence and then everyone's back up, like tweak it however you want. But. So kids really like that one. I'm really kind of shocked they like it.
I got this from Elizabeth, and another accommodation that I used for classes that you had a lot more kids who were lower levels, like I let them use the book, and so if they wanted to use the book, and if they could find the sentence in the chapter, then they could, that was an accommodation for certain classes that helped be
really anything where you're getting them to reread it and engage with it in a different way is ideal. It's great. So yeah, 10 sentences. The electronic part is nice with this and the Quizlet Live. You just copy and paste it in.
I promise this is super quick. We do like a board, a row races thing that's kind of similar to this. And it's like telephone, but basically you have a piece of paper that like you literally have the same sentence just typed at the top, and you just need one for like each of the rows. And then they have to illustrate that sentence, and then they fold the paper over so the next person can only see what they drew, and then they have to try to recreate it, and then you fold it back the other way so then they can only see what the other person wrote, and then by the time you get to the end of it, they're hilarious, like they're crazy fun. You can do it just English to Spanish, but pictures are much fun.
Yeah. Or you can also do it like at the telephone relay out loud, where they're like going to someone saying it, and then that person acts it out. Yeah, I think it can be really tweak a lot of ways.
You said the last student translated. Do you tell them whether they're correct and then they say sparkle? Is that what you're saying?
When they tell me the whole sentence?
Yes, the translation.
Yeah, I'll tell them if they're not correct, then it doesn't count.
But if it is correct, you indicate that then so they know, then they say sparkle.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So this was a group. This was when I was very grammar based, but this is them playing. And there's no sound, so I don't know if this will do us really much good. But they're going through. So it's just there. And The last basic one, I only did this once, and I did it because I was out of things that were unique. I literally just photocopied my 10 sentences and gave it to the kids, and they just translated it. You know, I think there's some things to be said for translation. My first TPRS training was about, like, establishing meaning with your target language and your L1 and all that. I still have students that do prefer that kind of more traditional stuff. I probably do the most grammar out of the three teachers in my last department. You know, and it kind of gives you a little bit of a break from having to, oh, you got 5 points, you got 3 points, oh no, you lost 2 points, why did I lose 2 points? Like, from the bickering, you know. And so I think there's something okay with translating, and it's great. And it's one way to kind of go in there, but pretty basic. So I hope this is kind of helpful. Really, the primary thing is have 10 sentences. These are quick things. Hopefully, there's not a lot of paper. I don't have to make a lot of photocopies for kids. Pretty quick. You can do almost any of these activities without a lot of extra prep work once you have your 10 sentences. And really just, you know, save your sanity. I think there's something to be said for pulling out a quick translation if it means you got to sleep in 20 minutes because your baby was crying all night, you know. So just be kind to yourself. Don't feel like you have to put in 20 hours to pull out one activity, and just be kind to yourself and have fun. I think that's the important thing.
A variation on your last one right there, I just thought of, is you could have them in, like, teams or in groups, and give them each the 10 sentences. I thought of two things. Like, I changed it up, modified in mid-thought just now. But, okay, so my second, with modification, everybody has the same 10 sentences, and you say, okay, start. So we all do number one, and then we're going to pass. And then the last person has to bring it over. Now we all are doing number two. Or that was the modification. Otherwise, you just start with one.
And you do the first one, and pass
it on the next one. Yeah. Someone does the next one. And when you get between your team, it's all the way through. They have to bring it up to the teacher to check. And real quick, you'd be like, oh, nope, not correct. And then the team works together to correct whatever was wrong or whatever.
Yeah.
Or modify that however, but to get.
Yeah. It makes it novel, it makes it different,
makes it collaboration.
Any others or anything you've done that's worked for us?
I just hope everybody probably already knows this, but if you don't have those whiteboards, you can just laminate a piece of cardstock.
Yeah.
And they don't erase quite as well, but I've had some that I used for years, and you can make one for every kid, especially if you're on a cart, which I've been. They're way easier to truck around to whatever rooms you have to go to, and easy to replace. You know, make a class set.
Want
to
go one more step of laziness?
That's even faster to do that if you don't have the laminating machine.
Yeah.
Or you can get a
people
shower board and have the industrial tech teacher come down.
I've done a game where it's a 10 sentences, it's 9 because it fits on a 3x3 grid a little bit better. And the students have to cut them up, so I don't have to do it. And then they put the sentences in order, but then you can start making variations on the games, like flip two of them around. So it's in order except two of them are wrong, and then you go to a new table, and the student who approaches that table has to fix it. Or turn two of them upside down, and you have to write on the whiteboard the sentence that's missing, or the one that's upside down.
I like that one.
Like different variations.
One thing I really started to like at the end of the year was blackout poetry, or where you like black out everything except the words you want to make a poem or like a short sentence or something. And it really makes them think and reread quite a bit. Maybe you'll do that in this very
They get gratification blocking, like out in the book or on the copy or whatever.
Yeah.
Like, that wasn't important!
I know. I did that with, Vida y Muerte, Mamá Escucha. He read that book, so it was like, I took like really deep parts of that book, and so they made some really like deep poems.
Yeah.
Really?
On the translate one, I did this with my exploratory, and you have one dice, and you have one writing utensil for the group, and they have to roll a certain number, let's say it's six, and when they get a six, they say safe, and then they get the writing utensil, and they start doing the translation while the other person is trying to get the six, and as soon as they do, they say safe, and then it passes on.
Oh, it's like my gym. I hate that.
And then when it's back to their turn, then they just pick up and they start where they left off. But in the meantime,
so really,
they could be
you've
looking
got
at their sentence and thinking what it is. And
I've had kids draw blood over that game. Because they do it with the dice, and I also have to like grab the pen and grab the paper, and they'll like claw.
Yeah, but like think about that. You could do that with anything. Where if it's like move a stuffed animal across the wall, or like the tire flipping, I do. You know, like you can really change whatever that task is, and it makes it unique.
Exactly.
Do 20 jumping jacks, add some gym, and yeah, I like that. Mm-hmm. Anything else you'd like to share for the greater good? Any good ideas? All right. Well, I figured it would be fast. But yeah, if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to me, or if you want to share anything. I'm always looking for things that make my life easier so that I can help myself and my family and my kids at the same time. So, thank you for coming.